It's senior day at Nebraska. Multiple layers of big red pride, of a life lost, of games played and careers yet to be finished. A special senior class gets its farewell on an emotional day in Lincoln. You're watching the Big Ten on ESPN as we welcome you to Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska. A chilly but fitting November morning for the second to last game of the regular season. It's the Maryland Terrapins at 5-5 and the Nebraska Cornhuskers at 8-2. We're glad to have you with us. I'm Mike Cousins. He's former college football head coach Dan Hawkins. Around the Big Ten, hope still springs true. Multiple teams still mathematically alive, including these Huskers. They need some help to jump over Wisconsin. Maryland out of the race in the East and looking for bowl eligibility. Tommy Armstrong, the quarterback here at Nebraska. Unfortunately for the fans, Hawk, not going to play today. Riker Fife in his place gets his first start at home.
Tommy Armstrong, the total yardage leader in the history of Nebraska football, hamstring, will not be able to go. Riker Fife, in fitting fashion, the former walk-on out of Nebraska. He can spin it. They're going to lose a little bit in the quarterback run game today for the Huskers, though, with him.
A native of Grand Island gets his second career start. 35 degrees. It was in the 20s just a few hours ago. So as the sun rises, so does the temperature. Not too windy here today. Third youngest coach in FBS is on the sidelines in year number one, DJ Durkin for the Terrapins. Former defensive coordinator at Michigan a year ago. Same at Florida as well. The Terps have won the toss, and they elect to get the ball here to get things going and try and jumpstart their offense. Drew Brown puts it in the air, and DJ Moore is back at his own 2-yard line for the Terrapins. Some large strides out toward the 35-yard line where he runs into Brown, and Maryland takes over to start their day. Well, it looked like it was about a 3-quarterback race this week, and it turned into number 4, who gets the start. Max Bordenschlager, the true freshman from outside of Indianapolis, has not played since the fourth quarter of week 1. Surprise, surprise, Dan Hawkins.
We've seen it all over college football. Quarterbacks getting banged up and dinged up. Getting his first start here in Lincoln won't be easy.
And it's a handoff to Ty Johnson, the sophomore running back from Cumberland and Maryland, on first down. He's going to be very important today with Lorenzo Harrison, the team's second leading rusher, suspended.
We'll see a multitude of backs coming in for Maryland, Ty Johnson being one of them, but really important that they get the running game going to keep the pressure off the young Max Bordenschlager.
The freshman goes underneath and connects with Laverne Jacobs to the 50-yard line and picks up the first down. Perry Hills have been the primary quarterback this year. He is out, will not play today. So the thought was, would it be between Caleb Rowe or Tyrell Pigram? One a better passer, the other more of a runner. And now a chance for Bordenschlager to show what he's got on a day where you expect to see perhaps a lot of rushing out of this Terps offense.
Yeah, this Nebraska defense much improved under Mark Banker, doing a great job in the explosion plays, better job against the rush. This black shirt defense has been a big reason for the improvement for the Huskers this year.
They go 5 wide here on 2nd and 7. 4-man Husker rush. There's plenty of time, looking one-on-one down the sideline. Intended for Wes Brown, and it's incomplete, 3rd down. Year number 2 for one of the most well-liked head coaches in all of college football, Mike Riley, on the sidelines for Nebraska.
What a special guy. Ton of experience. NFL, CFL. all levels of college football. Been roaming those sidelines. One of the winningest coaches in Power 5 football.
The Huskers show pressure from the short side of the field. There is a flag, so there may have been a foot across the line as Teldrick Morgan makes the catch and gets pushed out of bounds by Joshua Kalu.
Going to be important for the Terps to do a good job with the snap count, keeping that defensive line off balance just a little bit.
Defense number 24. Penalties declined. Result of play, first down.
Great drive to start the game for the Terps, doing a nice job mixing it up with different runs, different formations, getting into empty with a running back in the game personnel-wise. Really important for Maryland to have a good start. Obviously, they just had an extremely tough game last week and got to win one of two here to get in a bowl game to end the season.
Handoffer on the left side and a blocker in front for Johnson. It's a rushing attack averaging 214 yards a game on the ground. And if they finish the season above 200 yards on average, it'd be the first time since 2003 that a team at Maryland has achieved that.
Really felt like that was a reason. Of course, in their schedule going up against Ohio State and Michigan, nobody runs the ball against them much, but that's important for them to get it going today.
First carry of the day for Kenneth Goins. And it's sniffed out as he gets right back to the line of scrimmage. Really fires up the defense. Josh Banderas, middle linebacker, getting a hat in there.
The field was that the player was stopped by forward progress. Second down.
Mark Banker, defensive coordinator for the Huskers, not going to get real exotic on defense. They are a four-man front. They're a 4-3 team. Like to play quarters, keep it in front, run to the ball, keep your leverage, get in your gap, be aggressive. Play fundamentally sound defensive football.
Looking end zone and incomplete. Looking for DJ Moore. He would have been out of bounds. Some good time already here in the pocket, Hawk, for the freshman Bortenschlager, who is only 2-for-4 passing coming into this game.
Getting it out of his hands quick, which is important. Not going to have all day. That corner of the end zone, as you're looking down on the left-hand side, you can see the shadow angles. That ball coming right out of the sun. Tough to spot. It's a little bit outside, but that's a tough ball looking right into the sun.
Third and 10. Under pressure, and the pass is nearly intercepted. That would have been an easy takeaway for Nathan Gary. Almost had pick number 5.
One of the great players on this defense. Nate Gary, significant in every defensive category. Playing man-free, brought 5 that time. Got a little pressure up in the middle. Max couldn't get all the way over the top of that throw. Nate Gary wishing he would have caught it.
Adam Green is out there, the kicker. He takes the snap on fourth down and throws it out of bounds.
That would be much Mark Baker calls.
Thank you, Martin Hawk. It was Caleb Rowe. Now the backup quarterback. Nevertheless, trickeration goes awry on the game's opening drive. No points on the opening drive for Maryland that ended on a trick play gone awry. So Nebraska takes over. 12-12 left here in the first quarter. Surely some disappointment on senior day for the fans and for Tommy Armstrong. 43 career starts, 44 would have put him first in Nebraska history. But it is another senior who gets the call on senior day, Coach Hawkins. Riker Fife, a former walk-on, that's important here in this program, but it's only the second start of his career.
Tommy's hamstring limiting him. Over 10,000 yards, a career leader in total offense. Here in Nebraska, over Taylor Martinez. Phenomenal. All the great athletes they've ever had here. Tommy, number one.
Terrell Newby, the running back. He comes out of the backfield as it's a high throw and a one-handed try. Falls to the turf. Seathan Carter, the tight end, the intended recipient of Fife's 25th pass of the year.
They were anticipating Seathan to have a big game because he's been banged up early this year, and now his shoulder's finally getting back to 100%. Riker Fife, new quarterback. his best friend today is going to be the running game, the screen game, and being able to throw those intermediate throws to his tight ends and running backs.
Inside handoff, and that hole quickly closes. And there's a very short gain, if at all. Azubike, you can do. Coming up through the middle, the nose tackle there to help make the stop. And now it's third down and long for Nebraska.
I really thought this front of Maryland did a nice job against Ohio State. They just got wore down, made some nice plays early on, and that will be the case today. Can they hold up against a constant barrage of physical running attack that Mike Riley and Danny Langsdorf like to get into?
And how much will the offense change for Nebraska without the versatile Armstrong in the backfield? Fife over the top. He's got Jordan Westerkamp at the 44-yard line. The six-footer jumps up and comes down holding his right ankle after the catch.
Westy with a nice little inside seam over the outside shoulder. Great throw. It's like Westy got a little issue with his knee. That would be another tough blow. He's the go-to guy in this receiving core. Good protection up front, throwing it on time. Back foot hits, ball out. He just jammed it when he came down. Really good move, gets separation.
26 yards on the catch there for Westerkamp, a big part of this senior class, the top option in the slot for the Huskers, and their leading receiver in terms of yards and touchdown catches this year.
Good comfort zone throw for Riker Fife. Westy can't make it in. That'll be another tough blow to this offense.
Trey Bryant, the running back, to the outside. Gains a couple, and the helmet pops off there.
Number 23 for Maryland.
The end of the play. Jermaine Carter, their middle linebacker, a key cog for the Terps defense that averages, give it up, 31 points a game.
Trey Bryant, a true freshman, been primarily a kick returner this year for the Husker. They use a number of backs in this offense. Good little wrinkle. You can see a lot of formations by Danny Langsdorf and the Huskers trying to get leverage and angles on the defensive front.
Terrell Newby on second down. He's got enough for a Husker first down. It looks like there may be a face mask added onto this at the end of the play as a flag comes in at the 31-yard line.
Really good vision and patience. Danny Langsdorf talked about this yesterday.
Face mask. Defense number 22. 15-yard penalty added. End of the run. First down.
Just talked about the patience and really the versatility of Newby and him being able to see. You see right there, clearly hands to the face mask. But just a versatile back for the Huskers. Decent pass protector. Can catch the ball. Good vision. Really a versatile player in this offense.
How about the impact being felt of Carter out for one play? Davis, his backup, comes in. A rush of 11, add 15 for the penalty. Now they've got the ball right inside the red zone. Fife on the slant route. Beautiful throw right on target. They get it inside the 10.
That was a sweet little RPO. Had the zone. 2-on-2 outside. Maryland drops back into a 3-deep look. Reading that alley defender in the slot. You see his eyes out there. He runs to the outside. Throws a slant inside. Riker Fife doing a nice job. Danny Langsdorf doing a great job. Confidence throws early for the young quarterback.
First and goal after the catch by Brian Reimers. Left side, standing up, reaching out, and Terrell Newby is in for his 9th rushing touchdown of the year and the day's opening score.
Goes according to Hoyle for the Huskers. Really efficient by Riker Fife. I call him new. He's kind of new to the starting. He's a senior here. Obviously, he's not a young guy, but kind of new to the starting role. Great job getting him stopped on fourth down and then turning right back around and scoring. Husker's going to have a little voodoo themselves here on the extra point. Bruce Reed, longtime special teams coach for the Huskers. A lot of experience.
Zach Darlington, who is the holder and today's backup quarterback, with Fife in the game in lieu of Tommy Armstrong, out with his hamstring injury. Now gets them into their regular PAT formation. This one is up and good. Drew Brown, a perfect 35 of 35 on the year. Terrell Newby on his senior day. No rushing touchdowns last game against Minnesota for a running back. The Huskers are back on track and lead early 7-0. Capacity just over 86,000 here at Memorial Stadium in Lincoln. Today is the NCAA record 354th straight sellout. You have to go back to 1962, and the second closest in college football, Notre Dame. But a decade and a half behind, and Hawk, it leads us to tradition.
Some can match it. I don't think anybody can better it. When you look at the sellouts, the All-Americans, the walk-ons, the black shirts, the national champions, the list goes on. No place is richer than tradition than the Huskers. And on the other side, you have the Terps trying to get that tradition. New to the scene, new uniforms, trying to new into the Big Ten, all this stuff. But boy, there's nothing more special, I think, than a Saturday in Lincoln in Memorial Stadium.
You talked about it quite a bit. It's the type of place where the fans aren't getting to their seats at kickoff. They've been in their seats by warm-ups.
Packed, and you go all the way to the top of the stadium. Every row is filled to the brim, and just a special atmosphere all the way around campus. And walk past the national championship, the black shirts, leading the country in All-Americans, all the walk-on tradition, the great coaches, phenomenal.
The failed fourth down conversion ended the opening drive for the Terrapins. Ty Johnson takes it on first down, running into Josh Banderas. It's a bad streak going right now for Maryland. Without scoring on that offensive drive to open the game, they have gone 27 straight offensive drives without a touchdown.
Josh Banderas making that play, another former walk-on.
And DJ Moore makes the catch, quickly tackled on the edge, sets up third and short.
Josh Kalu makes that tackle out of Texas. You look at this roster. This is truly a nationally recruited football team. Guys from coast to coast, top to bottom, east to west, all over the place.
One deep safety as five men come defensively. Sideline again. Moore again, the sophomore from Philadelphia, first down.
Really nice job recognizing that, throwing the out route on time. They're doing a good job with Max getting the ball out of his hands, not making him hold on to it. Nebraska content to keep things in front, make them drive the length of the field. Modern day football, it's about scores per possession. Throw out the total yards. It's just a different game these days.
Bortenschlager trying to go underneath the third straight time. He's targeted Moore, and he couldn't hang on to that. So second down, imminent here for Bortenschlager, the freshman. It's a battle of backup quarterbacks today, and Bortenschlager seeing his first career start. Won a state championship in Indiana as a junior at Cathedral High School in Indianapolis. Hand off Kenneth Goins. Grabden has really nowhere to go with it, east-west of the 36.
Good open field tackle, talking to Mark Banker. They've worked a lot on tackling in the offseason, kind of broke it down into a science. when you play these spread teams and you're out there in space, you don't have any help. You got to come to balance, tamp down, get your feet apart, and get your hands on the guy and grab jersey and hang on. It's tough. You have no leverage with another defender many times.
Throwing through the sticks, and the pass tipped away, incomplete. Bring on fourth down. Antonio Reed got a hand on it.
Really good wrinkle there. Bringing five, dropping out. Reed punched out a defensive end. He got underneath that route. Max was not expecting that. You see pressure up inside. He was not anticipating underneath defender there. Lucky that ball wasn't picked.
Wade Lees, the former Australian rules football player, 28-year-old freshman, kicks it away. The ball comes loose. There may have been kick-catch interference there as DeMornay Pearson L. waved pretty clearly for a fair catch. Two flags down at the 30.
Easy call to make. You've seen a lot of Australian punters these days in American football. These guys grow up bouncing that thing around with both legs, doing it on the run. Very talented kicker. Looking into the sun again a little bit as well. Easy call to make.
Kick catching the interference. Kicking team number 21. 15-yard penalty. First down, Nebraska. Timeout.
DJ Durkin has questions. The answer right now is Nebraska up 7. Nebraska is up 1. Terrell Newby, touchdown to nothing over Maryland here at home. And in the Big Ten later today, it'll be Indiana and number 3 Michigan from the Big House. Can't overlook this one for the Wolverines as they look to bounce back after last week's upset at the hands of Iowa. 3:30 Eastern on ESPN. Also streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN.
All tied up in that Ohio State-Michigan State game. Don't overlook Indiana. Kevin Wilson, those guys can move it. We saw just everything blown apart last week. College football makes it so great that this conference is still wide open.
The Big Ten with 4 teams in the top 10 of the latest college football playoff rankings. Hand off for Newby on first down. And a gain of about 5 for the senior from Los Angeles, colliding with Jarrett Ross.
Great little run pass option for Fife. Little unbalanced box outside. Tried to force the defense to get out there and guard that, and still able to run the zone back inside with no edge defender.
And good news for the Huskers as Jordan Westerkamp is back onto the field. It looked like he hurt his right ankle on the opening drive. He had a 26-yard catch that was big on 3rd and 9 on that opening scoring drive. Fake the handoff to him on the sweep around. And a wide open catch at the 35-yard line as Brandon Riley, the Lincoln native on senior day, makes a big play for the Huskers.
Danny Langsdorf doing an awesome job mixing the formations and motions up. Fly sweep action. Got backs going every which way, throwing the ball on time. Crossing route coming across the coverage. Riker Fife now 3 of 4. Doing a great job in this game.
He was only 7 of 24. 1 touchdown, 1 interception in 5 games this year to start the day.
You see the multitude and diversity of formations and attack that Nebraska brings. You get into the spread RPO game. You fake the fly sweep. Now you come back in a traditional power formation. Run power. Very difficult for the defense to match up against this. A lot of subgroups running on and off. Now you get into the gun with 20 personnel. Haven't seen that set yet this game.
2 running backs, no tight ends, and the pass is out of the backfield, getting the running backs included there, and it's incomplete.
Mikael Wilbon. Yeah, out of Chicago. California, Texas, Illinois, Missouri represented in that backfield.
ruling on the field was an incomplete pass. Third down.
Tommy Armstrong, the senior, coming up just shy of career start number 44, which he'll have to wait until next week to see if that hamstring does heal for the season finale, the regular season finale in Iowa City.
Took a shot against Ohio State, concussion issue, made it back from that. Nobody doubts his toughness.
Third and real short, and nobody doubts the toughness of Jordan Westerkamp as well there. I should say third and 11 with Westerkamp coming across the formation.
And they're
going
to go
fourth and short.
Here's where you normally get in probably like a zone read, run option kind of a thing with Tommy Armstrong, but Riker Fife in the game, more likely to see more of a power run. Great job by Riker Fife, throwing off his back foot, going away with pressure up the middle. That was not an easy throw. Probably a stick route to the bottom of the screen down here. 3-by-1 formation.
Fife can move it. He's just got one man to beat to the outside, and he takes it all the way down to the 5-yard line.
He kept the same playbook for Tommy Armstrong as Riker Fife. Now, again, that was a run-pass option just with the quarterback. They did run a stick route down to the bottom of the screen over on the left-hand side. He didn't like the numbers. Runs it back up inside. Danny Langsdorf pulling out all the tricks.
Tommy Armstrong says, yeah, that looks familiar. I like the way you did it.
Great to see a veteran that excited for his backup. That's when you know you've got good team chemistry.
Luke McNitt at fullback. Newby trying to find the edge and hit from behind. His momentum carries him in for a second touchdown of the first quarter.
Outstanding speed. Play got belly back, spilled to the outside. Terps unable to contain it. Can you go from a spread quarterback RPO to coming back into 22 personnel running lead. Gets bounced outside. Can't contain it.
It's a big point of emphasis for Maryland defensive coordinator Andy Boo. After the last 2 weeks, the Terps got outscored 121-6 and already down 14-0. Could they control the gaps? Could they shut them down? Not so, so far against Newby and the Armstrongless Huskers, at least as it pertains to play on the field, but he's certainly making his presence felt on the sideline, where he's ended up because of what's happened to his body over the last couple of weeks, having to go through concussion protocols after getting knocked out of bounds at Ohio State, and then a not so fortuitous front flip to help win the game against Minnesota, and a tumble into the end zone that he hurt his hamstring on.
Coach Riley talked about his competitiveness. He said, man, you've just never seen a guy that wants to compete like this guy, and his toughness, one of the reasons the team rallies around him. You got a warrior like that taking snaps, makes everybody else pick up their game a little bit.
Spencer Lindsay's kick taken from the 4-yard line. DJ Moore for the third time today, getting some good return yardage out to the 30-yard line or so. And now the question will be, how does Max Bortenschlager hang in the backup quarterback battle today, as Maryland has gone two games and change now the last 2 weeks, scoring just a total of 6 points. Can they find the end zone?
Well, it's tough when you look up at your schedule and you go against number 2, number 6, and number 19 back to back to back. And you've got the freshman quarterback on the road.
Offensive coordinator Walt Bell said, look, we are a run-first team. Wes Brown, the senior from Baltimore, through the middle.
I really think in the Terps' case, Mike, you just have to be patient. It's a process. They're trying to build some things. You can't get antsy on the road and break your game plan here. You got to stay with what you do, even though you might lose on the points category a little bit.
Danger comes, and it comes quickly in the form of a blitz off the edge as Aaron Williams gets there and gets there fast.
Yeah, as you can see, they're out-athleted. They know they're missing some cogs up front. Pressure coming from the top of the screen late. Max doesn't see it. Now you're in third and long. Not good in any offense, particularly with a freshman quarterback on the road with so much noise. You got to throw for half, get the ball out, try to break a tackle, see if you can run for the next half of the yardage.
They set up the screen for Brown, and he's got momentum and open field ahead. Good play call there to help move the chains.
Surprised there weren't spies on that. Normally, Mike, you get in that kind of a down and distance, third and 10. Everybody's thinking screen draw. Normally, you have somebody assigned to hug up to the back. Surprised Nebraska didn't hug that.
18 yards on the catch and run. Play action. Going deep up top. Incomplete down to the 15-yard line. It was double coverage for DJ Moore.
Second interception that was dropped. Nate Gary was turning and running. I thought he was going to lose sight of the ball. Nice little job moving the pocket. Max protection, throwing the ball on time. They talked about not being able to come up with some of those turnovers last year, doing a better job this year, but that's two opportunities. Pegram now checks in at quarterback.
He's more of a runner, but he gives it off. Jake Funk, the freshman out of Gaithersburg, Maryland, as his first carry. So you've now seen all four options at running back between Johnson, Goins, Brown, and Funk.
I think it's great. In modern day football, you've got to play a lot of guys. You got to anticipate some injuries, get people involved. And of course, when you're going no huddle and going fast, you've got to have fresh bodies to get in there.
Pegram out at quarterback. Bordenschlager, the freshman starter, back on the field. Under a four-man rush, he steps up, runs with it, takes a hard hit, sandwiched by a pair of red and white jerseys. Antonio Reed, Nate Gary in there.
Really nice job squeezing that thing, leveraging the football, keeping it in front. Fourth down going to stay. This is what you have to be careful. Now, Max needs to think about sliding. They don't have many quarterbacks as it is. You don't need to take shots. You're not a fullback. Looks like they're going to go ahead and punt. Got to flip the field position a little bit in this game. There's that Aussie punt.
Pearsonell.
Look at that. That's nice.
Let's it bounce. And even better special teams coverage to down the ball at the 2-yard line. Ravon Davis. Covering a lot of turf.
Love that red zone punt. Probably the most underutilized. Notice how he's going to drop the point of the ball. The ball rotates like a kickoff. This is where a lot of people in the old days keep their feet on the 10 and don't catch it beyond that. These guys will knock it down inside the 10. Old school ball bounce. That's nothing for him. He's used to getting hit and those Aussie rules guys, man, they are tough, tough dudes.
Some swag for the 28-year-old as he walks off the field. Let's see what kind of push this Nebraska offensive line can get here, pinned back inside its own 5-yard line just to create some breathing room.
Full carry by number 18, Trey Bryant.
Trey Bryant on first down as Nebraska looks to go to 9-2 elsewhere around the league. Michigan State just trying to get some pride out of what has been a very down year for the Spartans. 7-7 first quarter against Ohio State. And Purdue could lend some help to the Huskers against Wisconsin.
Mike, we've had that Spartan team playing six true freshmen on defense. You got a backup guard playing D-tackle down to your third team quarterback. They have really, really been hit in the injury category.
From his own end zone, Fife slings it across the field. Catch is made at the 9-yard line. And a couple of jukes right to the sticks after the catch for Alonzo Moore, his first of the day.
Riker's done a nice job getting the ball out on time. He's got to be careful. This is where you don't have a ton of reps. He's back there dancing around in his own end zone just a little bit. You really got to be sensitive to throwing the ball on time.
Well, no Tommy Armstrong at quarterback today on Senior Day, but it is another senior, Riker Fife, getting the call. So far, so good for the Huskers. 14-0 after one quarter at home. It's a beautiful Saturday here in Lincoln. Mike Cousins, Dan Hawkins with you from high atop Memorial Stadium. 14-0, a big play coming up here. Third down and one. Ball back on the 12-yard line and see if this Maryland defense can get a stop and get the ball back.
A little unbalanced over on the right-hand side. Luke McNiff, the fullback in. Going to have a little bit of wrinkle here.
Lower the shoulder and pick up the first down. Trey Bryant, the freshman from St. Louis, gets the job done.
Nice. You know, in those situations, Mike, you always expect to go power football, but you don't expect to go unbalanced over to the right, motion back to the left. He picks his feet up here a little bit. Could be. Trey Bryant could be down the sideline. That was a good little wrinkle out leveraging back to the short side. Really tough for the defense to get lined up to all these formations and try to get everybody in a gap and get leverage. You see him running around here late. Motion.
And a handoff across the formation for Brandon Riley as he tumbles to the 30 and gains 13.
Breaking out a little fly sweep. Going all the way back. Lot of wrinkles. I'll tell you, you're on defense. Tough to come back with all this. Newbie out front. Seathan Carter doing a good job blocking on the edge.
Play action. Fife lofts it up. Third catch of the day for Jordan Westerkamp.
You love guys that can just go make a play. Now, that wasn't necessarily a clean read, kind of a flood action designed to get after more of a quarters coverage. Westy's going back to the flag. You got a post route over the top, but that's just trusting your veteran, going up and high pointing the ball, making a grab and covered. You got to have guys make plays on 50-50 balls, not just getting it when you're wide open. Go make a play when you're covered.
First and 10 now from the Terrapins 44. Quick throw to the edge, Alonzo Moore.
Mike, you are seeing the best of pro formations, West Coast, and the spread game here. That RPO outside, nice against numbers.
This college football season, stream every game live on the ESPN app and on Watch ESPN. You can download the app or visit watchespn.com today. We had the app going here pregame, watching College Game Day from Kalamazoo, Michigan. What a great story the Broncos under P.J. Fleck have been this year. Snow coming down. Fortunately, none of that here this afternoon.
Did Lee Corso row the boat? I want to know.
I missed it if it happened. Fife takes the timeout.
Charge timeout, Nebraska, their first. Be a full media timeout.
Only his second start, but he knows when he doesn't like what he sees. Looking at the race for the Big Ten, Here you got Wisconsin, and they are in the driver's seat, 5-2, a head-to-head victory against Nebraska, also 5-2, mathematically still alive. And Minnesota, you got a little bit further down. It's less than a 1% chance for the Huskers and for the Gophers and for the Wildcats as well. Now, Nebraska, with some help, still could end up in the Big Ten title game, assuming a win today against Purdue. For Wisconsin, they'd need Minnesota to pick up a win, and then, of course, need to win out today against Maryland and next week against Iowa. So if you don't like math, just wait till the end of Saturday to figure out how it all plays out. Fife called timeout. He drops back to set up the screen and dumps it off for Newby. He's going back across the field trying to pick up some blockers. Runs into his own teammate down at the 36-yard line. And that terminates a frantic play short of the first down marker.
Little mistiming in the backfield. Fly sweep action going. Yesterday I was at practice. A ton of screens. They must have thrown 15, 20 screens in practice yesterday to help out Riker. Newby takes off back across the field. He got boxed in by his own lineman and the umpire.
Another third and short for the Maryland defense. And it's a one-handed grab to the outside. Holy cow, what a catch from Westerkamp, who's having himself quite the day here before halftime.
Impressive. Impressive. Ever since Odell Beckham, now everybody catches it. The coaches yell out there, two hands, they look at you. Coach, we don't need two hands.
Not if I can do it with one.
Now, Freddie Biletnikoff used to have goo all over his arms. These guys with these gloves, they just sticks on there and they go.
Five tucks it in for Bryant. Off to the right side and off to the races, perhaps down the sideline. First down and then some to get it inside the 15.
Really got a nice bunch of backs here. Trey Bryan is 5'11", 200. Newby is 5'10", 200. Then when you could bring in, yes, that guy lined up is called a fullback. McNitt covers him up, hat on a hat. Gets enough of a piece. Cole Conrad trying to get outside there. A relatively new starter here for the Huskers. Well, you're defensive coordinator against all these formations and motions and shifts and personnel groups. That's not a lot of sleep for the Terps this week.
Getting some help from Conrad right through the middle. Bryant again. Conrad, the start at right tackle today in front of David Neville. So the sophomore over the junior, as Neville has battled some ankle issues, some shoulder issues, and so far the change has proven to be quite beneficial for this offense.
Down here is where Armstrong obviously came in handy, because you get an extra blocker with your quarterback able to run. But after the quarterback draw we saw in the first quarter, looks like they want to do the same thing with Riker. Probably not in the under the center here, though.
Ryan's with a five.
Doing a nice job banging it up inside just a little bit. Looked like Dylan Utter was a little bit nicked coming up. Kind of limping. He's waving to the sideline. He's a tough kid. Another walk-on. These guys come in here just tough dudes out of Nebraska. Love the Cornhuskers. Tough, hard-working football intelligence guys stick around, work their fannies off, win a bunch of championships for the Huskers.
Lots of pressure, and Fife goes down, grabbed by the shoulder pads, and he's down back at the 15-yard line. Shane Cockrell comes through to touch him first.
Yeah, he had a little action working outside to his left, ended up getting covered, and he didn't want to pull the trigger. Too much pressure coming from the edge. Sack better than an interception for sure when you're in the red area. Especially when you have a kicker like Drew Brown. This guy's solid. Actually sending in
Spencer Lindsey,
and the ball comes loose. The Terrapins touch it and then finally fall on top of it at the 27-yard line.
Good stop for the Terps.
Lindsey, the senior,
coach
on senior day. And that was real quick penetration there. No question that was going to get knocked away. J.C. Jackson got through untouched.
Two veteran special teams coach, Pete Limbo, head coach at Ball State, running the special teams for the Terps. Got a lot of experience running those special teams on both sidelines here today.
Bortenschlager hands it off for Ty Johnson. For Wes Brown, left side. What do you think it's like, Hawk, for Bortenschlager, the freshman, whose only experience in college was all the way back on September 3rd against FCS Howard, and his first start comes here?
Well, if he's the right kind of guy, he's excited. I mean, who wouldn't want to start at Nebraska in Memorial Stadium?
Hard run, Wes Brown going through the middle. And the reason Bortenschlager got the start, Walt Bell, the offensive coordinator, saying it was really his communication skills with the top of the depth chart knocked around because of injury with Perry Hills, the senior, out. Caleb Rowe has not been fully healthy this year either. And they felt Bortenschlager, one freshman, was a better choice over the other freshman, Tyrell Pigram. Now third down. Plenty of space in the pocket in the one-hand catch. DJ Moore trying to match Jordan Westerkamp and couldn't do it.
Moore did a nice job there getting his eyes around. Anytime the corner puts his eyes back to the ball, you can make a little contact. You have the right to go for the football. Where a lot of guys make a mistake, they just focus on the receiver, put their hands on him. Next thing you know, pass interference, easy call to make.
On the rollout, it's a pass on fourth down. Lees drops it off for Kenneth Goins, the running back. Got to watch out, special teams, and a team that has bowl eligibility on the line today, Maryland at 5-5.
Good little wrinkle. Pete Limbo, DJ Durkin, willing to take a chance, which I think is great. You're already down 14-0. You're not moving the ball much at all. A couple of big special teams play, the block field goal and the fake punt, keeping the Terps alive.
So first and 10 from the 39-yard line, a gain of maybe one for Brown.
For you folks at home, just start out with your eyes on the center where the ball is. All right, and just keep your eyes right there on that line of scrimmage, and you're going to see that red wave just kind of push those white jerseys back. And that's the issue. These guys know they want to run the football, but physically not matching up well against the Huskers right now.
Moore gets the set up on the outside. This will make it third and much more manageable for the Terrapins, something that Walt Bell, the offensive coordinator, said if they don't do a good enough job on first down and second down and have to work with third and seven instead of, let's say, third and three, the afternoon would be a lot longer for them.
Get into this. Third and three is really more of a passing down, but your whole three-step game is open.
And the red jerseys swarm quickly to Ty Johnson and force him backwards.
Maryland is having zero success with pullers. Good to do that. You create extra gap, but they've not been able to pull and trap and counter this Nebraska defensive line. Too much pressure. People getting up the field, creating havoc. Kevin Maurice right there, number 55, right up in the backfield. Disrupting.
Lees, after showing off the righty throwing arm, uses the much more conventional lefty kicking foot. Fourth down, they send it away. 6:13 to go before the break in Nebraska on offense. Nebraska's Sam Foltz was killed July 23rd in a car accident in Wisconsin. The 22-year-old was the Big Ten Punter of the Year in 2015. Former walk-on in this program from Greeley, Nebraska, joined the program back in 2012. Mike Riley said, it's not every week for this group that they remember him. It's every day, and a story that they don't want to forget around here. His parents, Gerald and Jill, here today as they have been for every game this year. And there's Tommy Armstrong laying flowers on his number. His teammate, his quarterback, Grand Island High School, Riker Fife, getting the start here on Senior Day. And Hawk, I think if we've learned anything from watching tributes like this, we may not know about life after death, but we certainly do know and have seen that there is love after death.
Yeah, this kicker-punter fraternity, these kids go around the country and travel each other. They know each other and respect each other.
It's a run on first down. Terrell Newby, who has two touchdowns on the ground today for the Huskers.
Great outside zone. The other thing about Sam, I think you get a feel for him. They did a tribute here in the stadium. He really was a special guy. He wasn't just another guy. I think he had a charisma to him, an energy to him that really endeared himself to the rest of his teammates. Obviously a great player. Mike Riley said he would have punted the National Football League for 15 years. Easy. He was that kind of athlete. And as you mentioned, the receiver catching number 17's balls in high school.
Fife, his high school quarterback, goes on the run, keeping the ball extended dangerously in the right hand, and goes down to the 28-yard line. Foltz got his degree, hearing Coach Riley talk about him in the pregame tribute on the video board, hearing teammates talk about him, a guy who came in as part of the walk-on program. And as he rose in prominence as a player and as someone who is beloved throughout this campus, still made everybody feel like they were his closest friend. Fife goes short on a crossing route for Brandon Riley. First down, Nebraska.
Shallow cross route, Mike. Riley's got to look out front. When you got an alley defender sitting there, you got to sit down. Once you get to that tackle on the other side, you've got to sit down. You got to see zone coverage coming across hard. Look in front. When you give the quarterback your eyes there, it means, hey, I got man coverage. I got space. Lead me. Otherwise, you've got to stick your head around, sit down in that zone. That little headache will teach him the difference between man and zone coverage.
Westerkamp in motion. Helps set up the run for Newby.
Good comeback, settling down, Riker. I really thought on that last bootleg, he shouldn't have tried to outrun contain, and then he's got the ball waving around in his right hand, tried to cut back. Outside the pocket, burn it. They're in good down and distance. Now they came back and made a good play to move the sticks, but stay in your lane, know your role, excel in your role.
Blitz through the middle, gets picked up easily. Newby goes to the right side and right to the first down marker at the 44-yard line. They've got the clock at 3.5 and the situation. They'll get the ball after halftime on their side. Tonight on ABC, we turn our eyes to the Big 12. Number 9, Oklahoma. Number 14, West Virginia in Morgantown. College football playoff hopes still live for those two teams. 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Also live on your ESPN app and watch ESPN.
Look out. Look out for the Sooners. Heating up a little bit. Lamar Jackson with a tough night. Maybe Baker Mayfield climbs a little bit higher. Nice open field tackle.
Alonzo Moore gets wrapped up quickly.
Three-yard takeoff, Miles.
Heisman race gets a lot tighter. The Final Four gets a lot tighter. Got a crazy race going on in the Big Ten. November. What an exciting time for college football.
It's a bullet back to Trey Bryant. He has been very impactful in the first half.
I would have liked to see him cut it back inside. I think he would have had a shot.
Flag down, coming late on the play as it's on the turf at the 46-yard line. Back in Husker territory.
You're going to get a flag behind the play. Always a cardinal sin. You never want a penalty, but certainly it should not be behind the ball.
After the play is over, personal foul, late hit. Offense number 67, 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. It'll be first and 10.
It's Gerald Foster, the offensive guard.
Lincoln, Nebraska, man. They've got several players from Lincoln on this team. Misdirection screen, as we mentioned. Little pump back outside. Starts to get humped. Good job throwing the ball under pressure.
Yep. And a push at the end of the play will do it.
Poise, poise under pressure. You like those linemen to be relentless, but also has to have some football intelligence.
Strong throw and off the fingertips of Mikhail Wilbon.
I disagree with you. Not a strong throw. I thought it was behind him. You got to put it right on his numbers there. I thought he kind of floated it behind him. You got to stick it on him. Gun it, plant it, Velcro it right between those numbers. Throw that ball, wave motion. See right here, I just kind of thought he floated it behind. You got to stick it right on those numbers in that case, in those running backs. Give him a chance.
In that case, I apologize for my assessment. I'm glad you're still able to disagree with me, but Fife's numbers have been good so far, 12 for 15. And some miscommunication down the sideline. Looking for Stanley Morgan, the first time he's targeted him today.
What happens in a lot of those go routes outside, Mike, when you get off coverage, a lot of them convert, pull up to a dropout route on the sideline, and I really think Riker thought that was what's going to happen. But clearly, he and Stanley were not on the same page. Understandable, given probably hasn't had as many reps as Tommy Armstrong with him.
No, he got a lot of reps this week and about 2.5 days of first team reps last week, and that's really been it for Fife as a first teamer this year. Going out of the pocket, can he pick up the one block he needs? Yes, he can. There he goes, back to the middle of the field. How about the vision for the senior Riker Fife?
This is so awesome, Mike. You got a former walk-on from Nebraska, gets a start on senior day at home against a packed house, and this guy's playing his tail off, showing he can run a little bit too. When he gets to the sideline, Danny Langsdorff's telling him to slide, though. Don't be trying to bend over, take people on.
They do not want to go any further down the depth chart today than Fife at number one. We got ourselves a timeout and a very heated DJ Durkin.
He's mad because they didn't hold up the snap on a personnel substitution, and he was trying
Charge
to sub guys
timeout.
In.
Maryland, they're first. This will be a 30-second timeout.
That's what he's yelling at. Should have went over and got over the ball and stopped play. Anytime there's a personnel substitution, the officials should stand over the ball and allow the defense to sub as well. They did not do that play.
Coach Hawkins, one more time. DJ Durkin getting really angry there right before the timeout. Why?
When Nebraska personnel sub, the defense has the opportunity to sub as well. The umpire should come and stand over the ball and allow the defense to get in there. They did not happen. And TJ, he was hot. He was out on the numbers. Fishel did a good job handling, though, because he was right, and they just got him off the field.
First down blitz coming, and Fife has to get rid of it. We're ready for it on the outside, so he's now 12 of 17 for 135 yards. And still in his first home start, just his second career start. The other one was last year, and a 55-45 loss at Purdue. This year had been 7 of 24 for 93 yards. So all things considered, replacing Tommy Armstrong, who's nursing a sore hamstring today. So far, so good.
What you miss in the stats there, though, that was smart just getting rid of the ball. Come back second and 10, you're good to go. You don't want to take another sack, you know, make it second and 17.
A wobbling ball in and out of the hands of Seathan Carter. Third down and 10.
Surprised they didn't target him a little bit more, being healthy. Rikers had such a good game. Seathan should have hung on to that one. A little high. But again, get both hands on it. That's a drop. You see the brace on his left elbow there. That thing was dislocated, I believe, early in the year. So he is just now getting back to 100%. For a tight end in this offense who's got a block and catch, that's hard on that arm.
Here comes pressure across the middle. Carter goes right back to it. He's into the red zone, first down on a gain of 15. He had hyperextended that elbow back on October 1st and back to about full strength.
Coming back to the shallow cross. This time you do get man coverage. Turn the head around, keep running.
Timeout for injured player.
Now that is a good call, what they're doing in the Big Ten. When you get dinged like that, they're going to take a look at it. I believe it was Isaiah Davis came up, and he just got rocked by Seathan. Right at the end of this play, when Seathan was about to get tackled, I believe it was Isaiah Davis who came up. Well, maybe not. I see him. He's standing out there. He's not getting... thought it was 22, maybe not. Right at the end of the play, big collision there. Seathan, big target right here. You're going to see at the end of the run. Ooh, head down. Got to keep that head up. Sorry, my mistake. That's Jarrett Ross, 32, not 22, 32. Gets his head down. All you young guys out there, keep your face up. You got to see what you're going to hit. Can't put your head down. He got rocked, and he got up a little woozy, was unstable. It's a great job by this Big Ten crew stopping this game, looking at it.
There is no targeting on the play. Number 32 of the defense needs to come out for one play for a medical evaluation.
And that's the latter half that's also very important to the conference and for the future health of these players, Hawk, is that you have a couple different people upstairs who can stop the game. You have a replay official upstairs, James Kimmerling, and you have a medical observer as well, who, if he deems that a player needs to be evaluated, will stop the game and make sure that the player goes to the sideline for at least a play.
It's
for
a
further
tremendous
team evaluation
addition to the whole thing. It's not just targeting, it's the safety. If somebody gets dinged, gets rocked, you got to take a look at him.
Taking a big shot to the end zone. A flag is down, and so is the ball. It's incomplete, but there are two flags thrown in the end zone with JC Jackson in coverage on Brandon Riley.
What an outstanding throw to Brandon Riley. That thing was right on the money, and he knows it. 6'2", like to see him go up and high point that thing, turn around, get his thumbs and fingers
defense
on it.
Defense, number 7, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Here not. You see right now when you're shoving there and not turning your eyes around, J.C. Jackson doesn't play the football, makes it an easy call for the official. Like to see Brandon Riley jump up there and turn his hands around, get his pointer finger and thumbs on that thing. just like you're going to rebound it.
Some obvious frustration from Riley, who does not have a receiving touchdown this year. He'd like to get one as a senior at home in his final home game. Going back to Newbie, he has had the magic touch in the red zone today. Two scores on the ground. Clock at 45 seconds here, and the Huskers will get the ball to start the second half as well.
Good penetration up inside by Maryland. This guy's playing hard. He's getting wore down with the variety.
Fife chased down from behind, tosses it up, and it's another flag intended for Westerkamp this time. Rayvon Davis trying to keep an eye on the senior from Lombard, Illinois.
Riker did a nice job getting it up early and getting it out, not taking the sack. He did take a hit, but throwing it out in front and giving Westy a chance. These guys, I love the competitiveness of these guys.
Defense number 21. The foul occurred in the end zone. The ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
They know they got opportunities to score, and they want to make them here on senior day.
He had them beat about two steps into that route.
Yeah, I don't know if I totally agree with that call. I mean, a little bumping, but the ball was thrown back inside. I think the defense has an opportunity to make a play on that ball as well, which he did, but I guess that's why I'm up here and they're down there.
15th play of the drive. Bryant gets drilled east-west by Chandler Burkett.
Chandler Burkett doing a good job coming off the ball.
Huskers stop the clock, looking to cross the point of the goal line. Off a timeout, it's decision time for Mike Riley.
That's what it's all about right here. Now, you got one timeout. I would save that for the field goal. I would try to, if you're going to run it, stay outside, fly sweep, or get something outside where you can get out of bounds. Or obviously throw the ball. Kind of go cross pass right here. Get somebody in the flat. Get somebody working back across the formation. Naked bootleg looks good out of this formation here.
Second and goal from the 4. Fife under pressure. Westerkamp hangs on. Touchdown, Jordan Westerkamp.
Go on ahead. Love the strong hands. Motion down into a stack formation and ran him inside on the slant. Most any time you get motion in those formations out wide, it ends up being a pass play. Maryland brings two guys off the edge. Riker stands in there. Good quick throw. Gets it out. Good snatch by Westy. Showing some toughness coming back off the injury. Showing up for his former walk-on quarterback.
Spencer Lindsay, the senior, on senior day. Westerkamp, a great grab. 5 targets, 5 catches, and now they're up 3 scores.
That's kind of a dagger because, as you mentioned, they're going to get the ball coming out of the tunnel. You see they peel on the back. Riker sees it, gets pressure in his face, delivers out front. Pretty well covered. C.J. Jackson right there. But the veteran playmaker showing why he's a mainstay here at Nebraska.
The scoreboard tells one story. The stat sheet just helps further illuminate the difference between Nebraska and Maryland today. The Huskers on that drive had 7 first downs. Meanwhile, the Terps, who are without a touchdown, now going on 2.5 games, 10 quarters, if they don't pick one up here. have 6 first downs today.
We've had a few of those this year, unlike the Huskers, who had 7 first downs in that last drive.
Short kick by Lindsay is taken at the 10 by Jake Funk. Our Week 11 Monday Night Football matchup comes to you from Mexico City, 8:15 Eastern, Estadio Azteca. It's the 6-3 Texans atop the AFC South, taking on the 7-2 Raiders. AFC West coming off the bye. Coverage starts Monday Night Countdown, presentado por Applebee's, a las 6, también streaming live por Watch ESPN.
I love you, Mike Cousins. Math, foreign language. What a Syracuse education you got there.
Oh, te amo tambien, Coach Hawkins. Te amo tambien.
That's the end of the first half.
Well, coming up amidst all this love today, and there's a lot of it from about 89,000 fans, we've got an ESPN News halftime report coming your way. 21-0 Huskers at the break at home on Senior Day. Welcome back to the Big Ten on ESPN at Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska. Halftime between the Nebraska Cornhuskers in search of win number 9 and the Maryland Terrapins looking to get to bowl eligibility at 5-5. My cousins Dan Hawkins here with you, taking a look back on the first half on this senior day, a very big for senior class, 28 active roster seniors, and of course the late Sam Fultz, who passed away on July 23rd and is well remembered here in Lincoln. It's been the seniors, Coach Hawkins, today that have been big, and it starts in the backfield with Terrell Newby.
Every great team has unsung heroes, and why the hero Armstrong's on the sidelines hurt. Other guys stepping up. Terrell Newby with a couple of touchdowns, showing some speed, some versatility. Riker Fife comes in doing a nice job, not only throwing it, but running it, showing his ability to get out and move with his legs and really avoid bad plays. Done a nice job. Had a couple sacks, but really doing a good job keeping things positive.
And his top target has been Jordan Westerkamp. He's thrown it to him 5 times. He's caught it every time.
Westy went out with a little bit of an injury early on. Almost every catch he's made has been in traffic, have been 50-50 balls coming back on the touchdown.
That one is 5th touchdown catch of the day with Tommy Armstrong, sidelined with a hamstring injury, looking on. Offense has been hard to come by for Maryland. Just 6 first downs, and now a streak that they'd love to put to an end has continued. They've gone 10 straight quarters without scoring a touchdown after coming into this game having been outscored 121-6 over the last 2 weeks. The foes were a little bit different in Ohio State and Michigan, but Nebraska has continued a trend of dominance. 21-0 at the break, and the Huskers get the ball to start the second half. Emotional day for the Cornhuskers, and so far what has been befitting of a very solid senior class, a good send-off, starts at a 15 or rather a 21-0 clip after 30 minutes of play. Riker, 5, backup quarterback. There was questions about whether he'd start this week in place of Tommy Armstrong. His first start ever here at home, and he's looked very good through the first half, Hawk.
A real testament to the tradition here at Nebraska. You got so many walk-ons doing a great job. This kid sees it through. Probably kind of could have went other places on scholarship. Probably could have played at maybe a smaller school. A little off the radar, but he sticks it out, shows up. This is what great programs are all about. Gets a chance to shine on senior day.
Westerkamp, not a Nebraska native, comes from Illinois, but their leading receiver, yards, touchdowns. Added to all of those in the first half, his fifth touchdown of the season. And the Cornhuskers get the ball here to start half number two as they look to improve to 9-2 on the season here in their penultimate regular season game of the 2016 campaign. Trey Bryant on the return sets things up, first down and 10 out of the 27.
Now, wait a minute. You just went Spanish in the first half and penultimate here in the second half.
Saturdays are not only for the boys, but also for polysyllabic words, Hawk.
You are spectacular. Just like Nebraska. These guys, about half of their plays were first downs. Scored late in the second quarter there. Really important for Maryland to try to get some sort of a stop, which they have yet to do much today.
A lot of early motion. DeMornay Pearson L comes from the far side of the field to get the carry on the run. Some surprising scores in first and second quarters around the Big Ten. Normalcy has creeped back in, at least as far as it goes between Wisconsin and Purdue. It's 35-10, which means that Nebraska fans are saying, all right, well, we'll have to wait till next week, see if the Gophers can get the job done against Wisconsin, with hopes still alive for them to play in the Big Ten title game.
Snow coming in sideways at that Ohio State-Michigan State game. Oh, we got a fumble. Good job, Riker. See, don't do something bad with something like that. Just get down on it. That's a smart football play. Give yourself a chance to fight right here. Yeah, there's snow coming in sideways, Mike. You could not do that Ohio State-Michigan State game. You'd have to phone that in from the truck there. You'd have to go to Orlando and do that from there.
You're exposing my fear of temperatures below freezing. Big game next week at Iowa as far as Big Ten West standings go. They don't hold their own destiny, per se, if Wisconsin does win out. Backing up and backing up. And the throw is just tapped down by Riley as Fife kept seeding ground.
Riley saved him a little bit. Now, Riker, I just gave you props for managing that fumbled snap. You're outside the pocket. You got nothing. Gun it. Here he ends up taking a shot, pumping the ball around. Right here, that's bound to be an interception. Riley did not come up with a touchdown grab earlier, but saved the interception.
And it was quite a celebration on the Maryland sideline. The first three and out they've forced today. So here comes Caleb Lightbourne and puts it down the sideline out of bounds.
Caleb was banging it in pregame warmups. He's a little better than that. Of course, he's probably been cold. He needed to run some laps around the stadium because he would not get any action in the first half.
33 yards on the kick, about 6 yards shy of his season average. Well, it's the battle of the backup quarterbacks today. Max Bortenschlager, the freshman from outside Indianapolis, first career start. What'd you make of his first half?
Well, it's very difficult. I bet he's done a nice job. They have not been able to get the running game going like they need to. And they tried a couple shots. And you see right here, another issues in the running game. Tried a couple of shots, but could not hit them. Really, the only things they had going in the first half were the blocked field goal and the fake punt.
Teldrick Morgan. 1 yard gain on first down.
Pegram back in the game. Maybe try to mix it up a little bit, get a little running quarterback game plan going.
He immediately tucks it and gets hammered to the turf by Michael Rose Ivy.
Not so fast, my friend. Great job. They did not go for the fake at all. Read the pull, stepped up. You play quarters coverage. Those safeties could come down in there and make plays. Great job fitting that. Leverage on the outside by Nathan Gary. Turned it back inside. Good fundamental defense.
Pressure on the way, right up the middle. And big hit in the backfield again. Bortenschlager folds.
Thought it was going to be close to a face mask. The hand was up high. Had press man up at the top of the screen. I think that's where he wanted to go. But pressure gets home. Twist inside. Ooh, it was a little on the face mask. I thought it was close. I was waiting for the yellow flag. Did not come out. Got space.
Personnel across almost the entire field. And a flag along the sideline. Late hit.
Tackle him on the white.
Or did they not throw a flag?
Guess you're going to get away with it.
Well, there's been a lot of action on the Maryland sidelines. With everything going the Huskers' way, maybe not anybody paying attention. At 63 years old, stops between Oregon State, the NFL, and just about everywhere in between. Mike Riley couldn't be happier where he is, and it comes off in talking to him. We said this before, that you don't really run across a nicer guy, and that's got to come across to his players, too, who feel like they're part of one big program. Exactly what he felt like under Bear Bryant at Alabama.
Mike Riley is one of the great, great people in this game, and he's so humble and so gentle, and what a great coach. And sometimes people, I think, have a misgivings about that. They want the coach that's demonstrative, but he is a very kind soul and really cares about his players.
He went in and wanted to be a quarterback, ended up as a defensive back. In his own words, said, you know, he was never really very impactful on the field. That's a great haircut there.
You know what he got, though, when he went to Alabama? He got the best thing he's got. That is his wife, Dee. He found her in Alabama, so it was all worth it. He wasn't the quarterback he wanted to be, but he found the love of his life, so it all worked out.
Fife fires incomplete after Tanner Farmer, his right guard, was getting pushed back right into his halo there.
Danny Langsdorf might be saying, hey, we're going to quit messing around with some of this stuff and just get back to running the rock here. Little off schedule in the passing game early on for the Huskers.
Now third and two coming up.
Terps continue to bring a little bit of pressure, crowd in the line of scrimmage.
They forced their first three and out on the last drive. They got a lot of shifting around. Westerkamp makes his sixth catch of the day, and he has a Nebraska first down.
Barely gets it on the RPO, flicking it back outside. Maryland reacting late, bringing pressure from the opposite side. Riker doing a nice job recognizing it, getting it outside. I think his decision-making has been pretty good today, particularly for a guy that has not played a ton of snaps.
No, had only played in 15 games in his career. Just one start prior to today. That was last year at Purdue. A high-scoring game. The Huskers lost 55-45. Westerkamp, the recipient again, who's going to finish his career Husker at least top three in catches, top four in receiving yards, and perhaps even better than that, depending on how things go down the stretch.
Again, phenomenal. You look at the accomplishments of the walk-ons on this team, the seniors on this team have really put up some phenomenal numbers. Tough year record-wise last year, had a lot of bad luck. And I know all those sayings about luck, but they did have some bad luck last year. But really panning out for them this year.
Newby goes right about to the sticks. They ended up, though, in a bowl last year. Finished
up
6-7 to the Foster Farms Bowl, played out in California.
Well, again, talk about luck. Part of it was their academic, their APR, and them getting into a bowl game because they only had 5 wins. But what a huge opportunity to breathe life into your program after kind of a year. And they get to go play UCLA and beat a good UCLA team and end on a really good note going into the offseason, and that's big. A little more emphasis on the running game here.
And after they pick up the first down, Newby gets it going to the left side. It'll be 2 bowls in as many years for Mike Riley, who's had quite a career and a league that holds a special place in your heart, the CFL.
It all comes from the CFL, Mike. You know that. Exotic football. But this guy's been around. You know, sometimes we discount experience anymore in this deal, and this guy's seen a lot of battles and a lot of schemes. Very level-headed, process-oriented, even last year. Tough, but he understood what was going on.
Fife on the rollout. Does a nice job finding Morgan on the comeback. And a first down to the 35.
Stanley Morgan out of Louisiana, of course, a state that pumps out a lot of NFL players and a good, strong Louisiana contingent on this team. The tight end, Seathan Carter, out of Louisiana. Nice little flick of the wrist there by Riker. Not an easy throw, kind of going away. Pretty good sting on the ball.
And a nice day for this unit after Keith Williams, the wide receiver coach, said during the week it's about as healthy as it's been all season. Brandon Riley, a senior from Lincoln.
I think moving forward for this Nebraska team, they got a nice, decent core. They really need a burner receiver. They need a guy that can really take the top off and separate. I mean, a legitimate. They got a lot of good receivers on this team, no doubt about it. But I think if they want to crease that next level, you got to get a guy that can really take the top off and somebody that really demands attention from the secondary, because they're doing a nice job. You just, Mike, there's a virtual cornucopia of offensive plays we're seeing from the Huskers.
That was a very good pre-Thanksgiving word. Well executed. Alonzo Moore with the catch on the 9th play of the drive. The definition is horn of plenty, which is why around Thanksgiving we see the cornucopia overflowing with gifts.
And a plethora of formations. I did go to college myself. Master's degree, too, just so you know. Not quite as efficient as the Husker offense, though, today. Great answer by Maryland early on in the 3-and-out. But getting back to the kind of the running game here, which has helped the Huskers on this drive.
False start. Offense, number 62. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Cole Conrad, the right tackle. And Stanley Morgan, training staff with him as he heads back toward the Husker locker room.
Got popped a little bit on that last play. Don't have the trainer's tent here that's popular around college football, the portable pop-up nylon camping tent to examine somebody on the sideline.
It's amazing how quickly those proliferated around college football. Once a couple big-time teams got them in the SEC, everybody had to have one. What a window to fit that ball into and get the completion. Fife to Pearsonell.
Darnell Savage was right there. I've been very impressed with the receivers being able to grab these 50-50 balls in tight coverage. Good throw in the right spot by Riker. Gets it in there. Impressive. Brings up another first down.
Bryant is in as the running back for Nebraska. He's got it. Quick cutback and stopped at the 22 for a pickup of a pair.
They've been doing a nice job getting in that tight bunch formation over there, which creates a couple extra gaps. And Maryland has yet to fit it really well. And they've been able to kind of get up in that C gap, D gap area around the tight end because you got extra folks. Maryland needs to come up with some sort of turnover. They got to get after that football, get a sack, penetrate, create some disruption. They do bring pressure.
On second down, Fife off the back foot, throws right to the sticks. Whenever he's been running backwards, he's always been waiting for something to develop, and it always has for him today. Brandon Riley there.
Had man coverage outside. Riley looked like he got popped a little bit. Man coverage outside. They've been running this bootleg with success. That's not an easy throw. Coming on the dropout route. Good catch. Went down hard at the end. Actually kind of got popped in the head, it looked like.
Now
personnel substitutions again.
One of nine different players to catch a pass from Fife. Timeout, Huskers.
Offense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Maybe they were trying to get the timeout and didn't
get there.
I think
Mike's a little hot because I don't think he thought the play clock was reset.
Before the delay of game, charge timeout. Nebraska, their first. Be a full media timeout.
4:09 to go in the third. A long drive. Husker is looking for Pater. Coming up later today, Indiana and number 3 Michigan from the Big House. You don't want to catch the Wolverines coming off of a loss, but that's exactly where the Hoosiers find themselves. 3:30 Eastern, also streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. 21-0 Nebraska, 4:09 to go here in the third. This has been a very long drive. And it's really been representative of what type of game it's been. Only 80 total yards for the Terps as Nebraska has held the ball almost twice as long as Maryland has controlled it. Newby gets the give. He's through the middle looking for his third touchdown of the day. All the way down to the 3-yard line. First and goal coming up.
Really nice vision on the zone. Good cutback, good patience. Does a great job of knowing when to slow down and when to put his pads down. Good versatile back, 200 pounds, big enough to run with a little bit of power, but also have some speed and agility and vision.
McNitt at fullback, Newby all the way deep. Newby left side. And Newby makes it a trifecta.
Going away from the motion. Luke McNitt, 41, the fullback. Leading off tackle. Covers him up. Newby having a big senior day for the Huskers.
His 50th game, the only senior to have played in all 50 possible games. Newby's third score of the day. The extra point is perfect. 28-0 Nebraska. Meanwhile, the defense has kept up its part of the bargain, pitching a shutout.
They'll never admit it, but deep down, Michigan and Ohio State actually love each other.
That's love. That's love.
No, they don't. Number three, number two, Ohio State, Michigan, the Saturday after Thanksgiving. That's a big one. They got to figure out who's playing quarterback. They're 3:30 Eastern on ESPN. O'Korn, Spate. Ohio State's got to figure out Michigan State. 10-10 right now. That one's been close all day. Wisconsin-Purdue started off real close. And then Wisconsin rattled off all 35 points in the second quarter as it leads 35-13. Also, don't forget about the NFL. Week 11 is here already, and you can start it with us on ESPN. 10 Eastern, NFL Insider Sunday Edition 11. Sunday NFL Countdown with Boomer and the gang, also streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Husker fans, remember this guy, the native of Oregon. Mike Riley tried real hard to get him to come to Oregon State. Didn't succeed. Husker fans not disappointed about that recruit that didn't end up on the West Coast.
Screen pass almost disastrous. Actually kind of surprised the Terps have not used a little more screens. What's difficult, you need some explosion plays. They took shots in the first quarter. Haven't seen any since then. We know you're built to run the football, but you need some play action off that. Now we got a fumbled snap.
Ball comes loose, and they fall on top of it. Going on almost the last 18 minutes of elapsed game time, and there have been just six plays run by Maryland. Six. They haven't scored a touchdown. They don't score in the next 3 minutes to the end of this quarter in 11 straight quarters.
59-3 against Michigan. 62-3 against Ohio State. As you mentioned, getting shut out here today.
Good. Just got to take off and run. Bortenschlager felt the pressure from Kevin Maurice coming up the middle that flushed him out of the pocket, and Antonio Reed finishes off the play.
So very hard when you're in Maryland's position. You just have to stay with it. It's brutal. You can't drop. You can't drop snaps and do those things that hurt you, but you're really trying to develop a young football team and get something going. You just kind of have to stay with it and ignore the score and not let things fall apart.
Fair catch, and the ball returns to Nebraska with 2 minutes left in the third quarter. Year number two, as we mentioned, for Mike Riley, and talked about his recruiting story with Ndamukong Suh trying to keep him in the state of Oregon. And Hawk, you know it real well.
I wish he would have. I wish he would have, Mike. Would have been a lot easier for me. But such is life. Yeah, dominant, dominant defensive lineman.
And a national brand, you got to be a national recruiter.
Yeah, you see, just spread out all over the place with Nebraska and everybody coming to the heartland of America. And it is a special place. Tremendous facilities, tremendous support. The sellouts, the atmosphere, pretty sweet for college football here.
Trey Bryan has some room. He's got a Cornhuskers first down. Divine Ozigbo, we were told, was healthy, the second leading rusher coming into this game, but have not seen him today. It's been Newby, Bryant, and a little bit of Mikhail Wilbon.
Yeah. Really nice complement of backs. They're all somewhat similar. Similar size, similar build, similar styles. They don't have the strong, powerful I-back, which I love on the depth chart here, the I-back going all the way back that they've had maybe in years past, but certainly a great complement of backs.
Brandon Riley tumbling for a first down.
Doing a nice job getting the ball outside. He's been very good on these run-pass option plays. Maryland is really yet to match up outside. You see the numerical advantage. You talked about math, Mike. It's really that simple. If they've got as many as you do, you got a chance. But certainly if you've got one more, get it out there.
Riley goes in motion. He takes it after making the catch and just ends up right back in the line of scrimmage.
Got to see the block of that inside receiver there. On that fly sweep and cut that thing up. Kind of tough. He just a couple back-to-back plays. A little gas. They're taking him out now to get a breather. Maryland has tried to bring a little bit more pressure to get after things up front.
They've got everybody within about 8 yards of the line of scrimmage on what may well be the final snap of the third quarter. That time the alignment pays off with Bryant picking up a yard and a half.
Darnell Savage playing quarters, four crosses. Safety's able to come down and get after the run game. Typically, you get teams formated like that. You're going to try to play action, throw over the top of that.
A brilliant performance from this senior class. 28-0 after three. 15 minutes to play from Memorial Stadium. Along with Dan Hawkins, the former college football head coach, Mike Cousins, rejoining you here for the start of the fourth quarter. How about this? A nice tribute along the sideline. Some Husker fandom shown as well. And, of course, a nice tribute to Sam Foltz, the late Nebraska punter, the gentleman who were in charge of the pregame flyover being introduced down on the field. Third and 8. Fife goes slant. Incomplete off the hands of Brandon Riley.
Kind of liking Riley here late. Thought he might go to the other side. He had a little bit of a mismatch, but a stack formation trying to get two guys on the switch route. Good stop from Maryland. See if they can get something going. They don't have a lot of shots left, I guess. Pass protection's a little difficult. Going to have to rely on the screen game and just try to get their running game. Get these young guys, try to get something positive headed out of Memorial Stadium.
First punt of the day for Caleb Lightbourne was 27 yards. His second out of the back of the end zone. Maryland will try and get on the board. ...28-0 Nebraska over Maryland as the Cornhuskers eye win number 9 on the year. And a look elsewhere around the Big Ten. Iowa up 14-0 over Illinois. Ohio State has pulled to a 1-touchdown lead over Michigan State. And Wisconsin, as expected, a hefty lead over Purdue. It was unexpected today to see Max Bortenschlager at quarterback for Maryland. Laverne Jacobs gets the catch there as Bortenschlager had only played September 3rd in a 52-13 win over FCS Howard. Was 2-for-4 passing and comes into a very difficult situation here today, trying to lead a 5-win team against the number 18 team in the country.
Chris Jones, number 8, got a good break on that ball. Thought I might turn it over there. Nebraska keeping it very simple right now. 4 down line. Playing a lot of quarters coverage. 4 deep across the top. Making Maryland just keep things in front. Thought we might see Pegram a little bit more in this half just because of his ability to run and get into the quarterback run game.
Bortenschlager outside the pocket. And the ball comes loose at the end of the play, in and out of the hands of Laverne Jacobs.
Great job by Josh Kalou getting that thing out. Pretty good throw by Max. Never over till it's over. Joshua, nice job just battling and staying with it. Getting that thing out.
And possession was never with Jacobs. Give you the picture of how dominant Nebraska's defense has been. They have not allowed a Maryland first down since the fake punt midway through the second quarter. ...14-12 left here in the fourth quarter. My cousin's Dan Hawkins, DJ Durkin's team. Perhaps we'll have to try and wait until next week at home against Rutgers to get to bowl eligibility. Third youngest Power 5 head coach. Started his career as a GA under Urban Meyer at Bowling Green. Coached under Will Muschamp. Last year under Jim Harbaugh. Without their second leading rusher this week in Lorenzo Harrison, suspended after being charged with second degree assault, reckless endangerment from the University of Maryland Police Department after an on-campus BB gun incident yet to be resolved.
Outstanding knuckleheadness.
Certainly part of the unlisted charges there, perhaps those from the coaching staff. Wouldn't have made a difference, you think, all too much with how strong Nebraska's defense has been today.
Here's where it makes a difference, Mike. It waters down your culture. It's like just blowing a hole in your ship. When you have guys that ignore the values and principles you're trying to teach them, and it just destructs everything you're trying to do. So now you got to spend all this time trying to patch up the boat that somebody's blown holes in instead of getting in and rowing in one direction. That's where it hurts you.
Riley with one hand was bobbling as he went out of bounds, trying to do his best Jordan Westerkamp impersonation. He did wear a Jordan Westerkamp jersey to meet with the media earlier this week, but couldn't hang on as he hit the white chalk.
Little pump fake and go. Great concentration. DJ Durkin was all over it. He was given the juggling sign to seal the call. We're going to go up top.
The ruling on the field on the previous play was an incomplete pass. The play is under further review.
All right, so we'll have several elements to look at here. Did the ball ever touch the ground is part of it, but then even if it didn't, was there any part of his body out of bounds when he gained firm control of the ball? And the question will be, Hawk, when he came down with his chest on top of it, did he still have firm control? Pass was called incomplete on the field, so is there indisputable video evidence for James Kemmerling, the replay official, to change the initial call?
I don't think so. I think he didn't really get firm control until...
After review, the ruling on the field stands, incomplete pass, third down.
That was an easy no.
Now, Nebraska fans, don't boo. That's against your reputation. Okay, the nicest fans in America, go with it. I think that was a good call because I don't think it was really firmed up until his elbow was laying out of bounds in the white.
That might have been the shortest replay review I've seen this year.
I like it. Go with it. There was not indisputable evidence. Move on. Speed up the game. Good work by the booth. Good job earlier when we had a potential... injury situation as well.
Incompletion. Duvernay Pearson L had it go right through his hands.
Yeah, had to go. We're going tunnel screen there. And okay, here's your arm talent comment. Okay.
Uh-oh.
Arm talent. Riker had to get that thing down a little bit and try to throw it underneath the rush, and I think it just threw him off a hair.
Morgan back at the 19. Wow. All the way back to the 10 where he bobbles it, and he goes down at the 7-yard line.
Been impressed with the open field tackling. Brad Simpson there making a play. Mark Banker talked about the tackling. How they've broken that down into a science. It's paying off for this defense and special teams.
And a big payoff comes tonight at 8 Eastern on ABC in the form of a battle in the Big 12. Number 9, Oklahoma, 14th ranked West Virginia. College football playoff implications. D.D. Westbrook. Going to be big. He's going up against Rasul Douglas. Offense, defense between the Sooners and the Mountaineers.
They've tried to get some of that outside zone stretch counter stuff going. Just really, they haven't been able to cave down the edge. Nebraska just too strong on the edges.
Nebraska's defense with a dominant third quarter, tallying minus 11 yards against them.
Well, and on the year, they've just dominated in the fourth quarter.
There's a big hole right through the middle. DJ Moore.
Just when I brag about tackling, it all goes south. And the Terps get on the board with a big old jailbreak screen.
There is a flag at the end of the play. A 92-yard catch and run for DJ Moore that breaks a touchdown drought. Going back quite some time to October 29th.
Nifty running combined with shoddy tackling there. Lack of poise there at the end. DJ Durkin not real happy.
After the play's over, personal foul, offense number 6. That penalty will be enforced on the kickoff. Touchdown is good.
Ty Johnson. Gotta be smart, gonna score. Yeah.
Why?
That would be the knucklehead disease continuing. Nice play, though. Good job. Like I said, you like to see your team finish. You got a bunch of young guys trying to get them to stay on track, accomplish something positive before you get out of here. And Nebraska's been dominant this year in fourth quarter, so good for the Terps to answer.
Before that play, Maryland had 88 total yards. Moore gets them on the board, going 92 on one play. Maryland getting its first touchdown in the month of November. DJ Moore, 92 yards for their first score of the day. Now a 21-point margin. Danny Sutton's got it on the tee. So they eclipsed their entire offensive production on the day with that one catch and run.
And now you got a 15-yard penalty, which negates. So now that Huskers will come out with a great field position, that's the thing that hurts you. You score 7 and turn around and have good field position.
Trey Bryant gets him out to the 35. And for what has been a very strong day for the Huskers defense, this play was not that. 6 broken or missed tackles.
Great call. Jailbreak screen. Had his eel skins on because nobody could get him. And a convoy of people coming down the field. I think Coach Banker will tell these Huskers to keep playing hard and forget about the score and remember their fundamentals. You shouldn't have that many missed tackles, and guys need to leverage the football and run to the ball. And they talked about getting back to some of those things here.
Newby on first down. Goes just shy of the 40-yard line. Riker Fife circling back for the former walk-on, making career start number two in place of Tommy Armstrong. Injured his hamstring last week, out today. No word on what his status will be for next week's game against Iowa on the road.
Those things are really tricky, and depending on the weather, boy, it's just you never really know. It's hard, and obviously as athletic as Tommy is, it's just you're just afraid to open up and run.
And you're not counting on 75 and sunny.
Exactly.
Saturday after Thanksgiving. But it's been a pretty comfortable lead all day for Nebraska. Never too many perilous situations. How much different do you feel like this game might be if it were Armstrong in there?
Well, I think Riker's done a really tremendous job. And really, if Tommy could have went, they probably wouldn't have run him much anyway because of his hamstring situation. But I think Riker's done a really, really nice job running in and throwing here. And that was not something you want to send home to mom right there. And again, he just didn't set his feet. And he's been used to whipping it around and not getting on balance and not getting proper body mechanics, and just did not quite have the arm to flick it back that way without his feet set.
It's the first time he's thrown in Westerkamp's direction today that it's not been a senior-senior connection for a completion. This is just punt number three for Caleb Lightbourne. One punt of 27, another of 53, and another beauty at the 11-yard line. Maryland's got the ball down 21, 10:46 to go, fourth quarter. Tonight, after a full day of college football, catch SportsCenter at night with Bucci and Anderson. They'll have all the gridiron highlights as well as the NBA, NHL, college basketball, NFL news, and everything else from a packed Saturday. SportsCenter at night after USC, UCLA on ESPN. First down, nowhere to throw it, and a slide before a collision with Josh Banderas for Bortenschlager.
Nebraska going back, just playing base defense. Coach Banker wants these guys to play fundamental football. Sure, they got a little bit of an earful on the sideline. They've been great in fourth quarter this year. Got to learn to finish games and play well. Credit the Terps for coming back on that huge tunnel screen for a touchdown.
Going 92 yards on the last drive. And Laverne Jacobs says it popped in and out of his hands. Third down and 7.
Normal situation if you had the kind of line you wanted, a little better in quarterback. Probably feel a little bit better now. They ran that screen last drive. Nebraska showing pressure, playing man. I thought that was knee on the ground right there.
It's ball on the ground. Incomplete. You're right, it was very close right there. The play could have been over really before it started.
Interesting. Nebraska brought pressure, played man. That's where you got to earn your money on third down.
It
that
was knee on the
down
ground
right there. Where's my Big Ten guys in the replay booth? They got the other ones right.
Would that be part of your...
Exactly. Live official in the booth.
Your agenda?
He'd buzz it down. Burp. Down right there.
Hawkins 2020. Pearsonell's got it after the punt from Wade Lees.
Yeah, these are the games, Mike. We've talked about this. When you're a coach and you're ahead, you know, you just don't want to see things deteriorate. You got to keep playing football, and you want to play at a high level. When your team, you're the team that's behind, you want to scrap and see your guys hang in there, not give up. And some of those things become more philosophical than practical, but they're important.
A win for Nebraska today sends them to 9-2, 6-2 in conference play. Wisconsin up 49-13 over Purdue after a game that started tight. So if it's going to turn out roses for Nebraska, they're going to have to hope for a win by Minnesota in that finale and get a win of their own on the road against Iowa.
Nice play for Kevon Walker. He had some really nice plays, I thought, against Ohio State last week. Good penetrator, gets off the ball, guy that can be a disruptive force in there.
Nothing doing on the perimeter. Westerkamp was the intended target immediately, and then the ball thrown over his head intentionally out of bounds by Fife.
Yeah, good job getting rid of it. I'd like to see Riker kind of, he's kind of getting his baseball thing going and flicking the ball around a little bit. I'd like to see him get with his mechanics, get his base going. He could throw the ball from a lot of different angles, but that kind of hurts you down the road. Good fundamentals will carry you through.
Newbie, even with a head first slide, not enough to get to the chains. Jermaine Carter, the middle linebacker, tripping him up from behind.
Offense is calling to go for it. I think they were signaling before coach was.
Looks like they're going to get what they want.
Probably a good decision. They need to throw a spark a little bit. This offense has been stagnant for some time and really looked erratic and inefficient. Senior day, sun's out. Finish strong.
And on fourth down, who better but Westerkamp to find right across the middle of the field for the first down.
Getting a little chippy down there on the field. Simple stick route. Everybody in America running it. And as you mentioned, that's his target.
Eight catches today for Westerkamp, including a touchdown, which was his fifth of the year. Almost a first down every time he's touched it. Lead blocker, Fife out in front for Newby. A full 11-man effort on the handoff play.
He was in the front. Your description of lead blocker, lead maybe.
He was leading and was ready to block if necessary.
He could have got a little more peace at the end there. Might have had a chance. Darnell Savage just sneaking in.
Now Bryant back to work in the backfield. That fourth down conversion real big because the Maryland defense had been much, much better in this second half. They had forced three and outs. So Mike Riley, Danny Langsdorf making a statement by keeping the offense on the field on fourth down. This is shaping up to be another one of those strong drives like they had in the third quarter. Take a lot of time off the clock and make a win that much closer.
You know, teams talk about four-minute offense, and it's obviously more than 4 minutes, but it's the same principle when you're up by this kind of a margin you get late in the game, you must run the football effectively. When the other team knows you're going to run it, everybody in the stadium knows you're going to run it, but you still run it. And that's where the strength coach and the O-line coach take a lot of pride in their football, because it up behooves the guys up front to start moving people, even though the defense knows you're going to run it.
And it's not fun to be DJ Durkin in this spot, where they've found themselves more often than they'd like over the last 3 weeks. But it comes back to what you said earlier, is making sure your fundamentals are sound. Westerkamp has the pass intended for him swatted away. That almost turned into an interception. Ravon Davis making a nice play.
Nice defense on the back end. Riker Fife with a pretty accurate throw, though, doing a nice job putting it on him. Ravon Davis doing a great job playing the football.
So fourth and six. Only field goal attempt today was blocked. Westerkamp comes off. Another senior comes onto the field. Sam Cotton, the tight end from here in Lincoln.
Bunch route on the bottom of the screen. Normally gets some kind of spacing route. Good blitz.
And they come right through the middle and put an end to that drive. Jesse Anabonum, the junior from Silver Spring, Maryland, with his team-leading seventh sack to give his team the ball back with 5:53 to play.
Hey, those are some things you can hang your hat on a little bit coming out of here. You got beat, but you didn't quit. Good blitz call. Unaccounted for.
And a loss of 13 yards makes it first and 10 on the 34 for the Terrapins.
Always trying to get you guys to finish regardless of what's going on and do something productive here. DJ could be a little happier on the plane ride home.
Trading sacks, one for one. All the way back to the 25, Ross DeZuris, his team leading fifth and a half sack.
And isn't it fitting? Yet another walk-on. Proof in the pudding. You come, you work hard, you're a tough guy, you're a team guy. You can end up playing pretty good football in a great program. And Ross not only sporting a wonderful mustache, but big heart and big talent as well. Deserves leads this team in tackles for loss and adds to a sack total of 5.5 now.
How about that handlebar mustache? That takes some
that
work.
That is sweet.
That takes curation.
That is sweet.
And mustache wax. Ball comes loose again. Another bobbled snap where it just didn't look like Borton Schlager was ready for it.
I think he was surprised on the previous drive. Unfortunately, they had some good things going. Actually surprised Nebraska's going with the punt return unit. They've been mostly just putting defense on there and going safe. The Australian is earning his scholarship.
Former Australian rules football player, 28 years old, worked in construction for a while before wanting to come play American football. Pierre Chanel out of bounds and no flags. Senior day has turned out pretty good for Nebraska. 300 career starts between the 28 active roster seniors and a piece in memoriam for Sam Foltz as well. Gerald, his dad, Jill, his mom, and his former high school teammate Riker Fife paying tribute, as this team has, as opponents throughout the Big Ten have all season long, and remembering Sam Foltz.
A lot of spectacular names on that wall of fame.
This will be a special day to remember as well for Fife, who had only started against Purdue on the road. Final home game, gets the start. In all likelihood, is going to come away with a win as well for a former walk-on. And to take the reins here and turn game number 11 of the season into a win.
This time you like to just get in two backs and just get it downhill and get the road grader working.
That's exactly what it looks like. Five, a solid day, 23-37. Showed off the legs a little bit. Showed off the ability to get downfield, block if necessary. Important, too, Danny Langsdorf said, just got to get some passes to get his confidence up. They didn't take the ball too far downfield. Westerkamp was a big part of that. Riley as well. Make the plays manageable. Make the situations manageable. Third down and one.
It's going to be a little short. Same unbalanced look they ran in the first half, but play broke a little bit farther outside than up the middle.
Fourth down, and not as far into plus territory. Becomes a special teams opportunity.
Coach Riley's going to congratulate his guys, hug them, tell them he loves them, but he's also going to tell them they need to finish. They played well in the fourth quarter. Kind of let off the gas pedal a little bit in this game. Credit Maryland for staying aggressive on defense and making something happen on the tunnel screen.
Teldrick Morgan started at the 13, covered a lot of ground sideline to sideline. And a return of six to set up the final minute and 31 seconds. Entering the day, playing the Big Ten West, Northwestern, Illinois, Minnesota, all mathematically were alive to be able to still win the West Division. Less than a 1% chance. And so Wisconsin is on its way to a win at Purdue. They got Minnesota next week. Nebraska can still win the division with a Minnesota win next week and a win over Iowa on the road. ESPN's FPI does not place the odds being great there. 87% chance for Wisconsin to beat Minnesota and Nebraska with a 40% chance to win at Kinnick Stadium.
We had Minnesota earlier in the year. Got a solid team. Nebraska had a battle to beat them last week. And as we've seen so many times, as everybody was ushering the Louisville Cardinal into the Final Four, and Houston said, not so fast. Very difficult to predict. No one would have predicted Iowa beating Michigan. As we've said many times, you get into November, you've really got to have a fighter's mentality. You're tired, you're beat up, you're sick of the routine. You got to really be tough, finish the season.
Four-man rush, screen set up nicely by the Terrapins. Laverne Jacobs going across the middle for the catch to the 35.
Coming back to the tunnel screen, didn't break this time. The Cornhuskers playing a little bit off, but managed to get it tackled.
Catch at the 40-yard line. Bortenschlager with the completion. Got a bit, another big game coming up in the Big Ten as well. Goal line will follow us here on ESPN News. as it looks like John O'Korn will be the guy today for Michigan as the Wolverines take on Indiana, going in place of Wilton Spate. And O'Korn, as you know, Hawk, really hasn't seen time as a starter anywhere since he left Houston. Was a starter there in 2014 under Tony Levine, and my, how that program has changed. And Jim Harbaugh this week refusing to confirm reports of a shoulder injury to Spate. Incompletion stops the clock. 14 seconds left.
DJ Durkin's got to stay positive with these Maryland guys. They got to come back and beat Rutgers next week to get themselves into a bowl game, which would be huge, both for the development and the emotions of this Terp program.
Portenschlager incomplete. We spoke with DJ Durkin yesterday. Said they're not worried about a bowl. That's not what they're thinking about right now. And you're number one for him, but
that was good political speak.
Yeah, it'll be on a lot of players' minds.
Yes.
Come next Saturday at noon Eastern, a game you can see here on ESPN News. Iowa off to a good start against Lovie Smith's squad, up 21-0 over the Illini. Moore had the lone touchdown catch today for Maryland. And we've got triple zeros on the clock. That is a final at Memorial Stadium. Nebraska 28, Maryland 7.
Charge timeout, Maryland. Please put 2 seconds on the game clock. 0-2.
Hey, Hawk, where did DJ Durkin coach last year? Oh, it was Michigan.
Play until the final snap. Going to work on a little last play of the game right here.
A little smirk from the first-year head coach. It ain't over until it's over.
Well, again, you're standing on the sidelines. You also don't want to.
And now, with a resounding thud, it's over.
That's the end of the game.
Maryland drops to 5-6, 2-6 in the Big Ten. Bowl eligibility at stake next week for the Terrapins. Nebraska, with the win, rattles off its second straight, 9-2, 6-2 in the Big Ten. And their hopes to represent the Big Ten West in the conference title game remain alive going into the final Saturday of the regular season. Senior Day, a good show for the almost 90,000 here in Lincoln that showed up today for the 354th consecutive sellout in this stadium's history. On behalf of our entire crew, especially those who brave the cold down on the field, my partner Dan Hawkins, Mike Cousins saying, thanks for watching. Goal Line.
Who just watched Nebraska beat Maryland 28-7. Welcome to Goal Line, presented by Capital One. I'm your